It's an honor and a thrill to be here this afternoon with you all. And I'm humbled to be amongst so many people that are committed to transforming education in whatever way possible. And so today what I'd like to do is share some of my work in creativity and educational settings. I'll be drawing primarily from my book, Killing Ideas Softly, but also from my other books and some of my more recent work. So undoubtedly, creativity is a hot topic in education. So the question is, why is this the case? Well, one reason I would say is because educators are recognizing that teaching and infusing creativity into teaching and learning can increase engagement, deepen understanding, and also promote joy in teaching and learning. Now, it might be tempting to dismiss this last one as somewhat frivolous, but Aristotle reminds us that joy is one of the few final causes in life. It is an end in and of itself and a legitimate goal. In addition to these factors, scholars have long recognized that creativity is necessary for survival. In fact, creativity is a capacity that has been identified to help us navigate uncertainties in our present day, but also uncertain futures. In addition to recognizing these kind of important attributes about creativity, I would say it's a hot topic also because there's deep concern that creativity is in a state of crisis. In the United States, an article came out on Newsweek magazine in 2010 claiming that there was a creativity crisis. Earlier this morning, we saw that nearly two-thirds, I think maybe it was exactly two-thirds, believe schools kill creativity. I'll pause for a moment and say, I don't believe creativity can be killed as long as there's life, there's creativity. It can be suppressed. And this is nothing new. Scholars have long raised concerns about the potential for formal school environments to suppress creativity, but it can also be nurtured in those environments. And I think it's important that we keep that in mind as well. So we have, on one hand, valuing creativity, its attributes, and concern that it might be systematically being taken away. When we value something and believe it's being taken away, that can be a powerful motivator. I worry, however, that it can motivate creativity mandates, which I think would be highly problematic. Putting pressure on teachers to seek out ready-made techniques and implement them kind of willy-nilly in any context, this would be highly problematic. Rather than spending the time to develop tailor-made techniques that meet the situational needs of a particular context, I worry that pressure would be placed on educational leaders, teachers, and students. These things would, in fact, undermine any creativity efforts. So my goals are a little bit more modest. I believe in order to really have creativity take traction in schools and classrooms, we need to kind of get to some taproot issues that have been with us that are long-standing. And those are some conceptual barriers that we inherit from our own prior schooling experiences about teaching, learning, and creativity. If you consider that it takes about 10,000 hours on average, give or take, to develop expertise in particular domains, such as chess or music and so on, by the time most students leave secondary school, for example, in the United States, they've logged far more than that, nearly 13,000 hours. The question is, what have they developed expertise in over those many, many hours? Academic subject matter? I would say probably not. But perhaps they've developed expertise in the schooling experience. That's what I would argue. That in fact, what we learn in school are deep assumptions, beliefs, and images about teaching, learning, and even creativity. That in fact, we inherit these beliefs from our own prior teachers, and those of us that go on to become educators can sometimes manifest these unwillingly in our own instructional practice. And as you can see, some students are heavily saturated with these prior beliefs, some are influenced somewhat, and some somehow escape these prior influences. So what is one of these beliefs that we can sometimes inherit? One I would say that is highly problematic is the notion that we should erase any opportunity for surprise or uncertainty to manifest. We teach prospective teachers to plan their lessons almost down to the very second. And so teachers come to believe that if they do not know what's coming next, that's a signifier of their potential incompetence, not a signifier of potential creativity. And I would argue that accomplished creators recognize that it is through surprising events, these kind of creative micro moments, that creative potential can and often does emerge. So what does this look like? What's the behavioral manifestation of this belief in the classroom? How do we seal off any opportunity for surprise to manifest? A practice that we inherit in schools, particularly in the United States, but I would say I've seen it in other contexts worldwide, is that teachers ask known answer questions, students try to match what is expected, and teachers evaluate students on how well they've matched those expectations. Now, this isn't always problematic. It becomes problematic when this becomes the way of teaching, the default, habitual way of teaching. This is when it becomes a problem. It is so widespread that even young children, when they're playing school, we know they're playing school because they ask known answer questions and evaluate to what extent whoever they're playing with can match. In fact, when my daughter turned 5 and started kindergarten, 1 week after kindergarten, she was playing school asking known answer questions to her dolls seated around her, to my shock. So I call this message that's sent through these practices, this is what can often be sent to students. Tell me what I want to hear and how I want to hear it. It's not about your own unique ideas or construals of this information. It's about matching to my interpretation as the teacher. When this becomes shot through the classroom every day, this is when it becomes potentially problematic. So I put it in this little notation to kind of illustrate it. So students and teachers learn that understanding or having learned something is being able to match what, that's the W, teachers expect, times how they expect it. Now, this multiplicative function is very important because in order to represent understanding or learning, you need both, right? So if you provide what is expected but not how, there might still be work to be done in the student's mind or the teacher's mind. And then, again, this has nothing to do with the actual understanding. It's the meeting of the expectation. So that multiplicative function is important. Now, what happens when we introduce originality into this equation? Well, originality is anything different than what's expected or how it's expected. So in turn, what happens is we can sometimes come to believe that learning and creativity are logically incompatible. And this is a hugely problematic belief that will impede our efforts to include creativity. This is where we start thinking that we need to add creativity time into everyday learning rather than see that it can be part of everyday learning and often is part of everyday teaching and learning. This is just an interesting little puzzle from perceptual psychology that I think illustrates the point. If we're so focused on narrow expectations, both our getting our students to those and having our students meet those, so look at that black dot in the center there. And those little powdered colored dots around, this is a static image, represent creative opportunities. Now, as you look at that, you should see that those opportunities disappear right before your eyes. So part of creativity in the classroom is recognizing what's right before us, what we typically do, the opportunities that are manifest every day. So let me make it a little bit more concrete. In second grade and third grade in the United States, students typically learn double column subtraction. They get introduced to that. They get introduced to a strategy of borrowing to solve problems such as this one. It's a very efficient strategy. There's nothing wrong with teaching that. So what typically happens is teachers are expecting, for example, this problem, the answer 9, and they're expecting the how using the borrowing strategy. What becomes problematic, however, is if a student provides the answer 9 and then says something somewhat unusual like this, I added 3 back to 6 and got 9. Now that's an unusual response. It meets the what, the 9, but not the how that we're expecting. So what we sometimes do in cases like this is say, why don't you think about that some more, and I'll call on somebody else who knows the answer. This is what I call killing ideas softly. If we just took a moment to explore, maybe we would uncover misunderstanding, but maybe we'd uncover creative ideation. But it requires exploring that rather than dismissing it out of hand. Here's another example. This is not what's expected, but how to solve is expected. And then there's this example, which is entirely unusual. What if a student wrote a poem like this? Mathematics is like a beautiful flower with multicolored petals. Subtract a petal and you still have beauty. How many of you would say this is creative by show of hands? Don't be afraid. Many people would say this is creative-like? Those of you that raise your hands, what would creativity researchers say about this? What do I say about this as a creativity researcher? I would say this is a highly original response to this problem, but it's not creative. Why? What we argue is that creativity requires more than originality. Yes, that is original response, but importantly, it's not appropriate for the task at hand. So a widespread definition in creativity studies that is widely held amongst creativity researchers is creativity is originality and task appropriateness as defined within a particular social, cultural, historical context. This is very important. So if it's just original and not appropriate for the task at hand, just like what we just saw in that poem, then we would say that is actually not creative. The nice thing about this seemingly constraining definition is it's actually quite liberating. It actually helps democratize creativity because it allows us to see, because of the virtue of the context, that there are different levels of creative magnitude. You don't have to be an eminent creator or generate an eminent product to be considered creative. A fourth grader can be considered creative within the context of his or her classroom. A person cooking in their kitchen could be considered creative in the context of that kitchen. A child can be creative in the context of one math problem. So my colleague James Coffin and I developed this 4C model of creativity, wherein we describe these different levels of creative magnitude, the first being mini-C creativity. What this refers to is anytime we have a new and personally meaningful experience, we can consider that creative. It meets the definition: new, task-appropriate, meaningful, in the context of our own experience. Other people do not have to recognize it as such. In order for other people to recognize it, it needs to move to the next level, what we call little c. This is creativity in the everyday context. So this is where originality and task appropriateness is recognized in the context of the classroom, or the kitchen, or out in the yard, or wherever you are. It doesn't have to rise to a level of contribution that changes a field or discipline. It could be creative in that context. The next level, however, is pro-C creativity. This is the level of creativity which requires deep domain knowledge and expertise. These are the kinds of creative contributions that make a difference to a discipline or a domain. And we would argue that this is probably the place that we can all aspire to, because the next level, big C, is eminent legendary creativity. This is out of the hands of the creator, right? This is often bestowed on creators after they're dead. So what we can aspire to is developing domain expertise and being creative in the domain, but we can also experience creativity through these various different levels of creative magnitude. And so we see this as a developmental trajectory. Starting with mini-C creativity, we can help students develop their mini-C potential into little-C creative contributions by virtue of providing feedback. We can go from little c to pro c by putting in many hours of deliberate practice and training in a particular discipline or domain. And we move from pro c to big C by a virtue of time and probably a great deal of luck. So in the context of the classroom, the most kind of important and most feasible place I would argue we should aim our efforts is helping students move from mini C to little C creativity by virtue of feedback. So what does that feedback look like? Well, what we talk about is oftentimes when students are sharing their ideas and they're just kind of percolating up, sometimes we will see the originality and we'll miss the task appropriateness. So kids that provide original but seemingly misaligned creative expression, what we can help do there is first explore what's going on there, give the kid a chance to articulate what might be happening, but also to help steer them to making it more task appropriate so that we can recognize the contribution in the particular context. Then there are kids who can match our expectations and how we want students to perform, right? And those kids can just mimic what has already been taught. And that's fine, but for those kids, we'd like to nudge them to be a little bit more novel, to put their own personal twist on it. So how might this look? Let's return to this double column subtraction problem. The kid who got the answer of 9 and said, I added 3 back to 6 and got 9, for this child, rather than dismiss it, We could say, help me understand where the three came from. I don't understand where that came from. And this is a still shot from actual footage of a second grade classroom where a child provided the following response to this problem. He said, I had 26 minus 17, I took the 6 and the 7, and I set those aside for a moment. I had 10 minus 20, which left me with 10. I took my 7, subtracted it from 10, that gave me 3, I added it back to the 6, that is 9. Guess what, folks? That is creative. It's novel, it's mathematically accurate. And we would have missed it if we told that child, you need to think about that some more because I don't understand where you're going with that. The most beautiful thing about this explanation in this lesson is you hear this little voice of a peer say, I now disagree with myself after this child explained it. The child that disagreed with himself had 11 and by virtue of his peer's explanation understood the logic of why it was 9. That's an example of going from mini C to little C in a classroom. Well, what about the kid who provides the expected response in the expected way? We can nudge that kid and say, great, it looks like you've got it. Now, how about come up with a different way of getting to 9? And so in our book, Nurturing Creativity in the Classroom, there's an example from a third grade classroom in China where the teacher put this story problem on the board, and this is the slight modification that I'm talking about. She simply asked her students, required her students, to come up with as many different ways to solve the problem as possible. So don't just solve it as many ways as possible. And students generated 15 or more accurate and original responses to this one particular problem. So what about the kid who writes this little poem? What do we do with this kind of unconstrained originality? What we would argue is developing creative competence also requires developing creative metacognition. In other words, we sometimes have to teach students that creativity has costs inherent in it. There are risks involved. And so sometimes it's important to know when and when not to be creative. Right? So imagine when I flew over the ocean here and we're on a routine flight. Imagine if the pilot came over and said, you know, folks, this is a routine flight, but I've been thinking about a creative water landing I'd like to try. We'd be, are you out of your mind? I mean, that's not the appropriate context. But if the plane, God forbid, was going down, right, then we'd say, by all means, pull out the creative stops, right? So there is a time and a place for creativity. For this child, we would say, this math problem is not the appropriate context for a poem, but this could be something we could develop in language arts, for example. One of the most lovely ideas from the American jazz musician Miles Davis is he claimed there are no wrong notes in jazz, just notes in wrong places. So I think this is something we as educators, parents, coaches can think about, that when students provide something that's original, we can help them find the place, the home for that creativity to develop. Okay, so it goes back to feedback. We would argue that when we're giving feedback, we want to keep two things in mind. We are trying to strike this just right balance, what we call the Goldilocks principle. And so what we want to do is make sure that we're not providing feedback that's too soft, doesn't meet real world constraints, but also not too harsh. Too soft feedback would just be simply telling a kid, no matter what they do, that they're so creative, just sprinkling rainbows and unicorns on them. And while this seems harmless, this can be devastating for youngsters when they meet real-world constraints. We see this on talent shows in America all the time, when students meet real-world honest judges and are devastated by their comments. Conversely, too harsh a feedback can be equally problematic. A phenomenon that I've been studying over the past several years is something I call creative mortification. So, just for a moment, have you or anyone you know had a creative aspiration, maybe to be a dancer, a poet, a mathematician, a sports player, whatever the aspiration might be where you might have creative expression? And in one moment of feedback, you hung up the dance shoes. One moment of negative feedback, you put down the poetry pen and never lifted it again. That's a devastating experience of talent loss. Again, what dies in that moment is not creativity, because creativity is there as long as there's life. What dies is the will to create. So what are some factors that could lead to this experience of creative mortification? What seems to predict it? So in a recent study, there were several factors that predicted it, but two that really stood out was the belief that ability was fixed. I can't get any better. Coupled with the experience of shame, this is a powerful combination. It's thereby too painful to pick the pin up again, because you don't want to re-experience that shame. But it's also an exercise in futility, you might believe, because you can't get better. These are throwaway moments, usually on the part of the teacher, parent, or coach who's providing feedback. It's how it's received and experienced by the person receiving it that matters. Well, not everyone who gets negative feedback or has negative performance outcomes is mortified. Some are motivated. What's the difference? Here are a couple factors I also identified. They seem to be older, perhaps a little bit more resilient. They feel like they were wronged rather than shamed. So they might be angry about what happened, but they want to prove the person wrong who told them. And most importantly, they believe improvement's possible. So I want to leave us with five things, and then we'll open it up for questions and comments. The first is really important. We have to believe that learning and creativity are compatible if we want to have any traction in infusing creativity in teaching and learning in schools and classrooms. And I think the only way to do that is to recognize that creativity thrives and often needs constraints. And this definition helps us recognize that. So I have a real problem with thinking outside the box, because in reality, we need to think creatively inside of many boxes. At times, we need to know when to create a new box, but most often, it is being creative within constraints. So that's why it's originality that's constrained by the appropriateness of the task, or in the case of the classroom, by the academic discipline. And then we need to hold our lesson plans lightly, those of us who teach, right? We want to allow surprises to emerge, and when they do, we just want to take a moment and explore first, then evaluate. Rather than dismiss out of hand or immediately evaluate, just take a moment to explore, then, of course, evaluate. And when we do evaluate, provide balanced feedback. It is critically important that we are honest with our feedback, but also supportive, demonstrating how students can improve. Thank you all. I look forward to your comments and questions.